When Serbian nationalists assassinated Archduke Ferdinand of Austria in June of 1914, it was just the sort of incident that former German Chancellor Bismarck had predicted would start the next European war.
Some damned foolish thing in the Balkans.
All the conditions for war were present. A substantial military buildup, a strong sense of nationalism, economic self-interest, and an outraged public, bolstered by political leaders ready to make the call to arms. What few people realized is that these conditions would lead to the First World War. Europe in 1914 was a strange quilt of military alliances. Germany with Austria and maybe Italy, France with Russia and maybe England. Countries were hinged together in armed camps, and conflict with one could quickly turn into conflict with all. Within weeks, a local problem had most of Europe at the doorstep of war. Tempers flared, pride swelled, and diplomacy faltered. In 6 weeks, the shape of the war was decided. On the Eastern Front, Russia attacked early, but without adequate planning, and the Germans inflicted a catastrophic defeat. Russia would not recover, and would quickly be occupied with its own internal revolutionary struggles. Germany invaded Belgium in August 1914 and drove the Allies back into France. There, the Allies regrouped and counterattacked, stopping the Germans in early September. Dead and wounded on both sides were already in the hundreds of thousands. Denied outright victory, each side dug trenches. Thereafter, they would fight for 4 long years over ground barely 50 miles wide, an ugly scar stretching from the North Sea to Switzerland.
Lamps are going out all over Europe. We will not see them lit again in our lifetime.
The United States must be neutral in fact as well as in name during these days that are to try men's souls.
As the war began, President Woodrow Wilson was determined to maintain a position of neutrality in the conflict. An American tradition dating back to the Founding Fathers, neutrality would not be easy, but it did offer certain advantages.
Jefferson talked about fattening on the follies of the old world, that while they fight, we get rich from selling all of them things, and that's the way the United States thought at this time.
Within a few weeks of the beginning of the war, it became clear that this was going to be a glittering opportunity for the United States economically. First of all, those people who exported to Europe, particularly in foodstuffs and cotton, which can be used for gunpowder, incidentally, suddenly found the prices of their products going up. The American economy is moving up rapidly, and that this is likely to continue, provided Britain and France are going to go on buying. But there was a problem. They were running out of money. And Woodrow Wilson had the problem of wrestling with that, knowing, of course, that he was getting deeper and deeper into a strong association with Britain and France. But the economy was at stake. Consequently, there was a steady flow of American credit going towards Britain and France, putting in question, really, the issue of impartiality.
A number of other factors also made it difficult for the United States to remain neutral.
First of all, geography. Britain and the United States are linked by the Atlantic. Secondly, the British had command of the seas, or at least the surface of the seas. And therefore, they were able to make their will felt by controlling commerce on the Atlantic, at least until the submarines got going. And then this is the whole question of the prior relationship of America and Britain. Geopolitics, geography, ethnic solidarity, all these things somehow seemed to push the United States towards becoming a kind of silent partner of Britain and France during the war.
It's difficult to remain neutral because neutrality works only as long as the nations at war, the belligerents, are prepared to respect it.
All the waters surrounding Great Britain and Ireland, including the whole of the British Channel, are hereby declared to be a war zone.
Nothing would influence American policy so heavily as German submarines. When Germany declared open submarine warfare in the waters off Great Britain, Wilson insisted upon defending the right of U.S. citizens to travel safely to Europe. The issue exploded when a German submarine sank the British liner Lusitania. Nearly 1,200 lives were lost, including 128 Americans.
It had a huge effect. It was the first time that World War I really came home to the United States, and I think that Americans had the feeling that this war could impact them and could impact them directly.
Theodore Roosevelt wanted the United States to declare war on the strength of this. At the same time, Bryan, the Secretary of State, wanted a soft response, recognizing that if the United States took a very hard line, that this might have the effect of eventually leading the United States into war. Wilson insisted in the end on forcing the German government, who were reluctant to do this, to apologize and offer all sorts of arrangements that were going to make the seas safer in future for passengers wanting to travel.
On the stump in 1916, Wilson touted his record keeping America out of the war. But soon after his re-election, events would combine to make continued neutrality impossible.
If success beckons, we must follow.
In early 1917, Germany again declared unrestricted submarine warfare.
They were getting quite desperate. The British blockade was really biting on Germany by early 1917. There was a shortage of food, vital resources. And so I think one can understand from the German point of view this sense of having to do something decisive. And this was the step they took.
Then in February 1917, German Foreign Secretary Arthur Zimmermann sent a secret telegram to Mexico, proposing an alliance against the United States in the event of war.
And of course, there's a long history of US-Mexican antagonism. So in a way, to the European mind, it seemed only sensible and logical to take advantage of this. But it was, of course, an inept piece of diplomacy. And it really was foolish, because there was no way that the Mexican government of that day was going to ally itself with Imperial Germany against the United States.
Amid further calls for war, Wilson severed diplomatic relations with Germany. After German submarines sank five American vessels, Wilson asked Congress to declare a war to make the world safe for democracy.
I think he has concluded by this time that he and the United States must influence the outcome of this war, that it must be a peace that's based on American-like principles, not old-style European power politics that have demonstrated their depravity in this conflict. And so it's Wilson's feeling that that the United States must play a role, that he must play a role, and that the only way they can do this is as a belligerent, not as a neutral nation.
The day has come when America is privileged to spend her blood and her might for the principles that gave her birth and happiness and the peace which she has treasured. God helping her, she can do no other.
In 1917, the United States was woefully unprepared for war on nearly every front. Industrial production was inadequate. The armed forces numbered only a few hundred thousand. And for the first time, the U.S. would need to raise and equip an army of millions to fight overseas. In a wave of patriotic fervor, many enlisted voluntarily. But it wasn't enough. President Wilson called for the Selective Services Act, the draft. 24 million men registered. Nearly 3 million were eventually drafted.
Congress established the guidelines for who would serve. Ultimately, it was established that all men between the ages of 18 and 45 would have to register. Now, some people, of course, would be exempted. Congress did not want the military making the decision as to who went, nor did the military in any way want to be the one making the decision. And so it was decentralized by being handed out to local draft boards. In effect, it was your own neighbor who served on the draft board who made the ultimate decision whether you're exempted or not.
While the draft process was local, most aspects of mobilization demanded a centralized effort.
The way we fight World War I is very much a progressive way. We create boards like the War Industries Board. We nationalized the railroad, something that the populace would have thought was a wonderful thing. We begin to use government and as a major player in the organization, along with business and labor, get some benefits during World War I as well, because they're brought to the table now in a very progressive kind of model.
In a final fling, progressives used the language and ideology of the war effort to achieve social and political reforms that had heretofore been stubbornly resisted.
The war affects both suffrage and prohibition, and the two are really closely linked because the Women's Christian Temperance Union for much of the late 19th century is a much stronger organization than the National American Women's Suffrage Association. Alice Paul and the Women's Party stages demonstrations outside the White House saying, "We want democracy in the United States, Mr. Wilson." The other group, led by Carrie Chapman Catt, decides that they will throw their weight behind the war effort, that they will be so super patriotic that they will be rewarded at the end of the war with the passage of women's suffrage, which actually does get ratified in 1920. Because of shortages during the war, prohibition also gains because alcohol is needed for the war effort. So both women's suffrage and prohibition get enacted after the war.
I should have been here 20 years ago. I just begin to feel like a man.
African Americans also saw in the war a chance for social improvement. A booming economy led hundreds of thousands to migrate north for work, often moving whole families, even whole churches.
The great migration of the World War I era had a number of sources. First off, conditions in the American South were, for African Americans, simply put, oppressive. The second impetus for the Great Migration was the availability of jobs in the North. With the outbreak of World War I, immigration from Europe was reduced to a trickle, largely cut off. At the same time, the American economy was expanding significantly. So where were American employers to turn to find workers for their factories?
The transition was not always smooth. White workers in the North often shared Southern prejudices. Realtors tended to ghettoize new arrivals, and violence broke out in some cities. But many felt an escape from the South was worth it.
Leaving the land of one's birth and one's family and one's ancestors was a way of saying, we don't like it here, and we're going to try something else elsewhere. Others were quite blunt in saying, I want to go to a place where I can raise my children without fear of being lynched. I want schools to send my children to. African American men can vote in the North. In short, there's a freedom in the North that doesn't exist in the South.
That which the German power represents today spells death to the aspirations of Negroes and all darker races on equality, freedom, and democracy.
Du Bois spoke out for patriotism in that war. African Americans thought that patriotism would leverage civil rights, that by demonstrating fidelity to the flag and to the cause, by shedding blood, one could win citizenship.
You're a grand old flag, you're a high-flying flag, and forever in peace may wave.
Once lead this people into war, and they'll forget there ever was such a thing as tolerance.
As part of the war effort, the Wilson administration formed the Committee on Public Information, which sought to rally support through a massive public relations campaign.
In its inception, the committee, I think, had a perfectly sensible, normal kind of charter, which was to provide information about the war. But it very quickly became a very enthusiastic, ultra-patriotic instrument. And the information function quickly gave way to a kind of crude propaganda function.
The CPI was followed by passage of the controversial Sedition and Espionage Acts, which allowed the government to cast a wide net in suppressing dissent.
There's also a very nasty side of suppressing dissent, and this is the number of political prisoners that Woodrow Wilson puts in jail for doing everything from speaking against the war to trampling on the flag. And this becomes an excuse to round up organizations like the Industrial Workers of the World, who are quite radical, and jail its leaders and end that form of dissent. So we have a massive violation of civil liberties during World War I.
Though America had a huge German-American population, they too became targets as anti-German sentiments swept the country.
There were some notorious episodes of lynchings and economic boycotts and some of this verging, of course, on the ridiculous, such as the substitution of sauerkraut for Liberty cabbage and getting rid of Germanic intonations in the language. But this was serious business for German Americans, who, on the whole, were very patriotic and were put at risk in areas where they were somewhat isolated.
While many Americans closed their minds to tolerance and dissent, troops leaving for France faced the unknown terrors of war and the sights of a foreign land most had only read about. Some would not return, but for many, it would be the adventure of a lifetime.
The arrival of the American Army in some numbers on the front lines by the summer of 1918 was critical. I call it M cubed. M standing manpower times morale times momentum. That's what the U.S. provided. First off, we provided the manpower at an absolutely crucial moment. Secondly, that arrival tremendously boosted the Allied morale, because they were desperate, they were on the ropes, and now all these fresh troops arrived. It also impacted German morale. The German generals had promised the German soldiers, the Americans will never come over here. And yet, here they were, and they weren't just a few, they were now over 1 million, and by the end of the war would be 2 million. And so the whole momentum of that manpower, that morale, now momentum coming at the crucial part of the war.
In a twinkling, 4 years of killing and massacre stopped as if God had swept his omnipotent finger across the scene of world carnage and had cried, enough.
On November 9, 1918, the Kaiser abdicated the throne and went to Holland. 2 days later, the armistice was signed to take effect at the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month. The Great War had ended.
An evident principle runs through the whole program I have outlined. It is the principle of justice to all peoples and nationalities.
Instrumental in winning the war, President Wilson was now determined to win the peace. Throughout 1918, Wilson had lobbied the British, French, and Germans to accept his 14 points as a roadmap for peace.
There's no doubt that when Wilson finally went to Paris for the peace conference, the 14 points was taken by liberals all over Europe and the world, not just in the United States, as a kind of charter, if you like, for a better world, reconstructed along liberal lines.
The problem Wilson confronts as soon as he gets to the negotiations in Paris is that, hey, not everybody else shares his vision of what the peace ought to be like. And that includes mainly his allies. Clemenceau said something like, God gave us the Ten Commandments, we broke them, Wilson gave us the 14 points, we'll see. The assumption being that these would be broken. And certainly they were challenged, and so Wilson had to make compromises.
Compensation will be made by Germany for all damage done to the civilian population of the Allies and their property by the aggression of Germany by land, by sea, and from the air.
Clemenceau wanted a tough peace on Germany. He wanted to dismember it, force it to accept guilt for the war, pay enormous reparations. He wanted to put Germany down to the point where it would never rise again to threaten France. Wilson, on the other hand, was wanting to see a restored Germany, and he wanted to hold out the hope to the German people of their reacceptance into the family of nations, because he saw Germany ultimately as a balance to British and French power. So you had the worst of both worlds, a treaty that was too hard for being so soft. And it was inevitable, I think, looking back, that at some point, some German nationalist politician is going to come along and raise the German people in the cause of rectifying the vicious Treaty of Versailles.
One major point that Wilson carried at Versailles was the creation of the League of Nations, a new organization designed to broker international disputes. But he still needed to secure passage by the U.S. Senate.
I have always loved one flag, and I cannot share that devotion with a mongrel banner created for a league.
It's a hugely complex undertaking. A nation which had not been a member of an alliance since 1801, a nation which, although it had been actively involved in the world in a lot of ways, thought of itself as having a strong tradition of what was coming to be called at this time isolationism, to move a nation from that into a full-fledged and unqualified commitment to a world organization is a huge step.
Facing staunch opposition, Wilson went on a nationwide speaking tour in support of the League. Exhausted, he collapsed and had to return to Washington, where he suffered a massive stroke.
Many people have speculated that his illness enhanced his sort of natural cussedness and stubbornness and partisanship. And so the United States is really drifting without leadership during a critical period when more than two-thirds of the Senate favored involvement in some sort of league. But you could never produce a working majority out of that. So it's a great tragedy.
In the end, ratification failed by 6 votes in the Senate. Ironically, Wilson's vision for a world safe for democracy was defeated by the machinery of democracy in his own country. Billed as the war to end all wars, World War I solved few of the world's ills. In its bloody wake, it left a communist Russia, a bitter Germany, a disillusioned America, and a mass grave for a generation of French, British, and German men.
Wilson, in the rhetoric of the war, had placed it at a very high idealistic level. We're going to make the world safe for democracy. It's going to be the war to end all wars. Well, in Europe, the American soldier for the first time came face to face with the depths of European hatred. And by the time the war was over, they really just wanted to get home. They were proud of the role they played, but they said, we haven't made the world safe for democracy. This isn't going to be a war to end all wars. The Germans and the French hate each other so much, let them raise another generation, and they'll be right back at war again in 20 years.
The effect was disappointing in the sense that the high hopes and ideals of 1917, say, or even of the 14 points period of early 1918, which envisaged an American participation and leadership role in the international community, that obviously was not fulfilled. The fact of the matter is, I think, that the American people were simply not willing to follow the lead of the Wilson administration in 1919-1920.
I think he's without a question the foremost figure in American foreign policy in the 20th century. There's so much that reminds you of Wilson, that it's still out there, still very much out there.
It's a very broad kind of legacy, obviously, but I do think it's an authentic one. I think that clearly Wilson set a standard. He was eloquent. And yes, despite all the changes that we've seen since World War I, his message of an American mission, of rationality, good faith, self-determination, free trade, hostility to imperialism, colonialism. I mean, these are all still very much at the heart, I think, of what many Americans still believe. It doesn't necessarily predict American conduct, but it's there for the rhetorical explanations.